thought I would start with like the first project that I, the first file, the first draft, which I just heard, and it sounds kind of awful, but then you know how it starts. So actually, these two were like, it was started with a guitar and the vocals, and I did already have the lyrics when I tried this out. So this was like the first try. That was like the first try to find the right chords. So I'm like, trying things while I'm singing. Also trying to find a vocal melody while I'm trying to find the chords. That's also why it sounds like it sounds. And then when I could hear that, okay, I'm gonna try this, then I tried to put some drums to the guitar. And play the guitar and sing on top. So that's where the next step comes in. Yeah, so now I open like the last project I made before I went into a real studio to re-record some of the instruments. So here's like everything I did before, before re-recording drums and
stuck to a bass in full worst case scenarios.
So here the drums are like made up by like drawing, so you can see like you have the different things. And then you kind of like do the math and draw them in, and then you make a loop so it goes continuous. And this is one part of the drums, but then they're also divided into like, here's the hi-hat, and then here's the kick, and the snare probably, and yeah, different things here too as well. Actually, with drums I feel kind of embarrassed now, because I have actually developed since this is a long time ago, so now I think I'm much better at this and making the drum sound better, different effects, and I'm also just sounds better now when I'm working on music these days. Okay, so this is the project I had in my hands after being in a real studio, in Kenneth Isaac's studio. And yeah, he was the person who played drums on the album. So what we did was that we had the draft, the demo, on, like he had him in his headset and then playing drums on top of it. So we really turned up the hi-hat, the volume of it, and yeah, and the drums. So it's So the thing about being in a studio is that, which can be complicated is that you, or at least with this song, actually this was the only song this was happening to, but when we were in the studio, I heard the drums, I heard the bass, and I was like, yeah, this sounds super cool. It's also like the bass here in the chorus. But it's not always just about, okay, this is great, this is cool. It's also about, like, the song, does it fit? And sometimes it's easy to get a little bit blind when you're in a studio. Because cool and great and good doesn't necessarily fit to the project. And with this song, I really, really wanted this chill song, a feeling of being underwater. And I didn't want, like, I wanted more, like, So the problem that I kind of had with this song was that when I came back from the studio, I realized that, oh, now it feels like a different vibe. And that could be okay, but with this song, it lost its meaning to me, kind of. So even if this bass was much better than what I can produce myself, I kind of had to re-record the bass again by myself on a guitar, because I don't have a bass guitar, so on the bass strings of the guitar. And yeah, this cool distorted bass is on the rest of the album, so I wasn't scared that I would not have it anymore, because I have it in other songs, this sound. But yeah, so I had to re-record it after by myself. This bass is, by the way, by Eskil Myrvold. And then you had this really, really nice synths. But the thing is also that this song also got way too many layers, and I don't want every song to have hundreds of layers, because sometimes you can't hear the kärna in English, the ground, the song, kind of. So I actually couldn't, in the end I had to choose what to take away, and I had to take away all these synths. Sounds like a waste, but that's how it is after being in the studio, that you have to sometimes let something go to give space for something else to shine. Yeah, so now I've opened up the project, which is like the last project I touched before I sent it away to Philippe Chaubois for really do like the last mixing, professionalizing the sound, doing everything I'm not comfortable doing. Yeah, so a lot has happened in here since the last project you saw. Yeah, we can start with the vocals. So what I always do with my vocals, and have done since I released my first song, is that I think normally in pop songs, at least, but probably for every songs, I think it's normal when you do, like, you double your vocals, you put an extra layer of your vocals on top of your vocals. I think it's normal to listen to the one you already recorded, and then you sing on top of that to make it similar. But I don't want them to sound similar. I want it to sound like two different people singing together, but that they have the same kind of vocals. So I am hoping when I'm recording the second take that it won't sound like the first take. Hopefully some notes are like not exactly the same, and one word is a little bit slower than the other. That's my goal.
Worst case scenarios, I see signs with warning signs. I try telling myself.
Okay, I have been better at not syncing them before. This is not the best example. And then in the chorus, I usually do like at least three tracks doing the same thing as in the verse, or maybe I'll do like six, sometimes eight, if I really like make the vocals, I pan them out to the side to make it like a wider, almost like a choir. But here only three. And then
I don't mind.
You can hear that I use a lot of reverb, and the only way to kind of do that without the vocals not being unclear, disappearing, is that I don't put reverb directly on the track. I send it through a bus or a channel and then put reverb on there. So then you can still hear the vocals clear, but you can still have tons of reverb because I'm very much fond of reverb. I use this one called Gothic Cathedral, which is very nice. Yeah, I used to, on my older albums, it used to be Waves, the reverb from Waves, but now it's this classic, very normal Valhalla room. Yeah. And I used to, on my vocals, to use this effect called Vintage Exciter from Waves to make it a little bit distorted, crackling. But on this album, I wanted the vocals to be more clean. Yeah, to try that too. And then there is backing vocals, which, okay, they don't have to be so clear. So they most often have a reverb straight on top of them. And they're like completely wet. Very into reverb. And then I thought one funny thing is that so my dad, he plays harmonica, and we tried it out on some songs, but I said already before we started that I don't think I will have harmonica. But then there was this one part which I kept in this song a few seconds.
That's why I keep my distance, to avoid my biggest fear.
Yeah, very cool. The thing is, I added some effects to it, so it doesn't really sound like a harmonica right now. Because of the song, it would fit better with effects. So, so I both use reverb, but also this little altar boy, which is called an effect. So without the effects, it's like. Yeah, so effects, then things can be whatever. And another thing which I think is very cool, which I probably shouldn't tell you what it really is, because then it will probably be less impressive or cool. But I think it sounds so cool, so yeah. Yeah, so that's like I recorded the synth, but then later I put it through this actually experimental virtual amp in Logic called Hemis filter, so it sounds like a ghost. So then I both have the dry boring synth and also then this with the effect, and I have sent it to, so one is in one ear and the other one is in the other ear. Yeah, I think it really does something. And then yeah, there is some guitars here. I've also done the same thing with a second guitar I have in the chorus, which is also sent through a virtual amp after. I also had it through a normal amp first. Yeah, and I'm not doing much there. It's not an impressive guitar thing or anything, but I really feel like these three chords somehow, just by, like, I don't know if emphasizing is the right word, but just by like highlighting them, I think that does something, and then I like the sound a lot. And then, yeah, guitars, bass, and one thing that was kind of complicated with the drums was that I have had actually muted the hi-hat, in the drums, my drums, before going to the studio, but we took up the hi-hat for Kenneth to hear where to play. To get the timing right, but therefore there was maybe a little bit of a misunderstanding. It's normal to use hi-hats, but actually I forgot to say that in these verses I didn't want hi-hats, so this made me kind of try to cut out some of the hi-hats in the verse to make it less intense, because it wasn't chill enough, so I had to make it chill by taking them away from part of the verse. And then also to make it even more chill, I had to take out some kick hits. So this is the only song I've like ever cut into the real drums, and you're probably not supposed to do that, but you can. Everything should be allowed. So this made it, the way I wanted it, more chill. And another a very nice thing that Kenneth do is he sends the drums through this preamp called Fat Boy, and makes the drums really like fat and nice, very good. Another thing about his studio is that he has this synth drum, Synare, which also Joy Division used the same one. So we have that same drum you can hear in he sent me two from my last album, because the drums were recorded at his place then too, and you can hear it in this one. Yeah, that synare, that type of drum, you can actually find as a sample online too, just so you know, if you're making music. What else is there to say? Yeah, one thing was that re-recording the guitar, I was really, really like using a lot of time trying to figure out, because it would be normal for me to record this with a lot of distortion and effects, but with this song I was like, maybe it's nice that the guitar is a little bit clear. So I actually did record it with not so many effects, kind of clean, but then I thought, but it's kind of a little bit boring, or it's sending the wrong message about my music. So then I also, after I sent the same guitar recording, I sent it through my physical amp after, then with a lot of effects, and then I took just panned out the one clean guitar to one ear and the other one to the other one, so then you get a little bit of both. Actually, it wasn't so distorted, but a little bit more than the clean one, at least. Yeah, and with bass, I've been very into having this sound, this specific sound, which is chorus on the bass, and playing a little like higher notes. If that's how you can, if you can say that. Maybe it's not the bassiest bass, but that I felt secure that Philip, the mixer, I thought he will boost the low end and make it more bassy. These days when I'm working on music, I am doing that myself, because I still don't have a bass guitar and I'm recording bass. But yeah, I have had faith that he would fix it, and he has. Yeah.
I don't mind. I've been stuck to a basic for worst case scenarios. This is hindsight warnings. Everything needs to be quiet. The ceiling could fall down.
Yeah, if you're wondering why I'm suddenly going down again here to this quiet part, you might think, oh, because that's what a lot of people do. But actually, I didn't have that part first, but I suddenly wanted it because that part of the song, that vocal melody, and that's the part I like the most. So I thought, I need to have this again somewhere. And then I thought, okay, I really like if I really want to show it, then it needs to be stripped down. So it's not a choice because it's like a thing to go down suddenly after the last chorus. It was actually because I wanted it again. But sometimes I do this also for variation and dynamics. Yeah. Okay, I don't know what more to say, so thank you for listening, watching. Goodbye.